Thank you for coming. I know you're all very busy. I appreciate your time. And I also want to thank Cass for having these series of lectures. It's great to not only become a professor, which was very exciting, but also to actually have a chance to talk about my work. So I really appreciate that opportunity. I also want to begin by acknowledging that reconciliation is unfinished business. And I also want to, I'm going to be having, I've got a PowerPoint which is on a loop that I'm going to just be playing while I'm talking. And if you've got questions about the PowerPoint, which you may have at the end, please, I'm happy to take questions about that. And that's kind of in parallel with the talk that I'm giving. So, research is being conducted on diverse anti-gender mobilization campaigns in Europe, and I'm interested in thinking about this research beyond Europe and in the Australian context. And I'm considering how ideas and tactics from diverse European campaigns may inform Australian campaigns. And my specific focus is on how anti-gender campaigners are seeking to influence the provision of education about gender and sexuality in Australian schools. Drawing on Eric Fasan, and I apologise at the outset for my appalling French, it never recovered from high school, and his study of gender norms and sexual democracy in France, I consider how anti-gender campaigners deploy common sense understandings of gender in order to oppose discussions of gender, sexuality, and diversity in education. I also touch on the challenges of negotiating diverse gender perspectives in ways that can attend to religious freedom and sexual freedom. But I want to begin with a story about gender and education that involves me and my dad. In 1997, I had literally just commenced my PhD, and I had flown interstate to attend a weekend induction outside Deakin in Geelong. My dad drove down from Melbourne to collect me from following this weekend away. He's always been incredibly generous in this respect. I had found the weekend to be intellectually stimulating and was keen to talk. On the drive home, Dad asked what my PhD was going to be about. And in order to avoid talking about queer theory or sexuality, I told him it was going to be about gender and education, thinking that that would be easy. I thought, and so Dad and I do not share worldviews when it comes to gender and sexuality, and I didn't want the long ride home to be awkward. My response prompted another question: what's gender? I gave him my best rendition of Judith Butler. He listened, paused, and commented that all I needed to know was that there are boys and there are girls, and that was all any of us needed to know. The conversation turned to other topics at that point. Dad's response reflected what many still believe: there are boys and there are girls, and they are meant to be together. The fact that it hadn't worked out quite this way for two of his five children never seemed to shake Dad's faith in the power of this basic Catholic teaching, and I can attest that it's still firm today. I recollect this conversation at the outset of this talk because it speaks to me of the common sense of gender. It also signals my belief that it is important to be able to talk about gender, sex, and sexuality in ways that can reflect the complexities learned within the field of gender studies, but do not do this in a way, but do this in a way that can appeal to the common sense of gender. Plain speaking about gender, I think, has been key to the success of anti-gender mobilisation campaigns. And a key point is that academic and activists within this space need to engage in conversations about these campaigns in ways that expand these common sense understandings without talking down to people who share beliefs like those expressed by my dad. So, what is an anti-gender campaign? Many people have asked me in the last few weeks. I understand this idea of an anti-gender campaign building on the work of Roman Kuhar and David Paternotte, to describe, and they use it to describe European campaigns that are in opposition to many things: progressive gender equality, manifested in challenges to marriage equality, abortion, reproductive technologies, gender mainstreaming, sex education, sexual liberalism, transgender rights, anti-discrimination policy, and even to the notion of gender itself. In the Australian context, one might argue that the heated national campaign against the Safe Schools Coalition is one example of an anti-gender campaign in Australia. And the Safe Schools Coalition is a national coalition of organisations that promote inclusive school environments for same-sex attracted and gender-diverse students. So I'm trying to situate this campaign that's been happening in Australia as but a small cog in a series of campaigns that are happening internationally. In Australia, these campaigns involve several actors, and two of these, the one I'm going to focus on most today is the Australian Christian Lobby, but I think that the Catholic Church in Australia has also been quite focused on attacking this idea of gender in the way I'm trying to describe today. In pointing to the Catholic Church, I also wish to underscore the diverse perspectives on issues related to gender, sex and sexuality associated with both Catholicism and Christianity. I don't think that this is a settled issue within those organisations either, and I want to be clear about that at the outset. Such campaigns are increasingly being understood as part of a transnational movement, and the Catholic Church, writ large, I think, is part of this movement. So understanding the Safe Schools campaign as a purely Australian phenomenon could be read as a case of methodological nationalism. In sociological discourse, such campaigns might be described as a moral panic or sex panic. Janice Irvine talks about sex panics as meaningful and scripted forms of political communication in which moral entrepreneurs seek to reinforce conservative ideas about sexuality. The notion of an anti-gender campaign expands on this understanding of moral entrepreneurs focused on sex, which has been, I think, the subject of much of the recent contestation related to the Safe Schools Coalition, to think explicitly about the emergence of movements which are being described as anti-gender. Esther Kovats, writing about the emergence of anti-gender movements in several European countries, goes on to connect these movements in part to the rise of the far right in Europe. I think that we can also see like very strong instances of this in the US, which I think will be another part of this paper, but no room for that today. She notes that these movements are mobilising against the enemy that they call gender ideology, gender theory, or genderism. Under these labels, various issues are united and attacked by conservative, partly fundamentalist groups of society. So liberal, green, or leftist politicians, women's rights activists, LGBT activists, gender policy officers of public administrations, and gender studies scholars have found themselves put into the same gender ideologist or genderist box by these movements. Kovats hopes that by studying these anti-gender movements, it might be possible to better understand what enables them to mobilise successfully in some contexts and not others, and to grasp the broader societal and political framework that provides fertile ground for them. Importantly, Kovats also dismisses, and this is a really important point, the idea that these interpretations of gender are in any way naive. She says that anti-genderism, the idea that anti-genderism is a misunderstanding by ignorant people, and that if the concept of gender and gender equality is just explained in a more understandable way, then they will know that there is nothing to fear. And I think that often educational imperatives around gender and sexuality are trying to educate people in the right way to think about gender and sexuality. And I think that people really are pushing back very strongly against that. And I think that that's part of what's going on here. So far from being a misunderstanding about gender, Sarah Brack and David Paternotte, in a piece entitled Unpacking the Sin of Gender, highlight the ways in which the term gender ideology is being crafted to perform a particular rhetorical labour. It's conjuring a vision in which the spheres of beliefs and ideas are separated from the sphere of reality, and gender is allocated to the former, thereby undermining the knowledge production and truth claims of many decades of gender studies scholarship. By invoking both common sense and hard sciences, such as biology or medicine, they aim to dismantle a wide array of research in social sciences and humanities, and notably, but not only, research that's inspired by a post-structuralist approach. In one piece I read in an interview with somebody who used to work for the Vatican but doesn't anymore, there was a comparison of Isis and Judith Butler as a binary, which I think is like an interesting manifestation of how like the problem of gender is being, you know, arced up. Grasping the ways in which gender ideology constructs gender studies is important in attempting to unpack some of the particularities of critiques on programs like the Safe Schools Coalition. But what's also required is an examination of the increasing popularity of ideas associated with gender ideology. In part, this paper is intended as an argument for the need to not only attend to specific campaigns against gender, but also to look to the bigger picture and inquire into why such campaigns are gaining purchase in Australia and internationally. Eric Fasan, who's a French sociologist, is useful in thinking about the answers to these questions. He argues that in France nowadays, the interrogation is not so much, as used to be the case, how can one be a homosexual, but rather, with the same disbelief, how can one be a homophobe? I think this is quite important, and thinking about debates in Australia that are going on now, I think it's very hard to be like publicly homophobic, to say that, you know, it's not okay to be gay. Certainly, I think that an institution like this, like publicly stating a position of homophobia, has become more difficult. But I think that positions related to gender have a different inflection. And that's an important part of why this move to gender, I think, is happening. And that's part of Fasan's argument. This shift is echoed in opposition to the Safe Schools Coalition in Australia. I think they were really focusing on issues about gender in regards to safe schools that they were saying was like beyond the bounds. Opponents recognising community shifts in relation to LGBTI communities have focused on the well-being of children, not on the production of homophobic rhetoric. Because of increasing support for marriage equality, strategies have needed to be developed that can garner support for critiques of gender ideology, but not be read as explicitly homophobic. So Fasan asks how polemics against gay marriage can turn into a polemic against the theory of gender. For him, this transition can be traced back as far as 1995 and the Catholic Church's response to the Fourth World Conference on Women in Beijing and the evocation of Judith Butler's theory of gender associated with an influential text, Gender Trouble. Publications of the Roman Catholic Church, Fasan argues, set out to delegitimise gender studies because the field, he argues, suggests that there exists no such thing as a natural man or a natural woman and questions to what extent there exists any natural form of sexuality. The theologians in this lexicon thus express fears that the denaturalisation of sex, operated by gender, logically leads to the denaturalisation of sexuality, as evidenced in claims for opening marriage to same-sex couples. So these debates about the common sense of gender are ongoing, and they have spread into many different country contexts, as the slides suggest, including Australia. And Fasan sees the need of these campaigns in the concerns of Catholic theologians regarding marriage equality. He sees that as the seed of this debate, but also like going back to the 90s in Beijing and some of the conversations about how gender was defined post that conference are really interesting to revisit in light of debates happening now. In a piece entitled The Uses and Abuses of Gender, Joan Scott, an historian and a key figure in the foundation of gender studies in the US, takes a different view. She argues that gender is a site of struggle about what counts as natural and what counts as social, and she really emphasises that these don't divide simply along right and left lines. These debates about gender are misunderstood, Scott suggests, if they are reduced to discussions of sexual progressivism. For her, questions of gender are indivisible from questions of sexual difference. She asks, why are there men and women? Must I be one or the other? Why not both? the nature of the attraction between these bodies, these are questions for which there are no single rational or unconscious answers, she says. So Fasson and Scott draw attention to the ways in which debates about sexuality have become associated with debates about gender, and Scott highlights the unresolvability of questions of gender, while Fasson perceives these debates as a struggle of democracy. I find both explanations helpful in attempting to unpack the anti-gender campaigns in Australia. So following on from this discussion of the anti-gender campaigns and this notion of gender ideology, I want to briefly look at an anti-gender campaign in France and Australia. Critiques of gender and its role in the denaturalisation of sex have been the subject of many heated protests in France. Most recently in debates against marriage equality in 2013, and in debates about a school program designed to educate students about gender beyond the frame of inequality that was launched in 2014. Alistair Bridges, writing about the gender education reform program, which was called ABCD de l'égalité, characterises it as aimed at combating sexism and gender stereotypes. He argues that the idea of the program was to teach children that some differences between the sexes are biological, but others are socially constructed. It was met with fierce pressure from conservative and religious parents, angry that their children were being taught gender theory at school. And there were huge demonstrations in France around this issue. It was a massive political issue. So Bridges notes that the movement against the education program reunited practicing Catholic members of both the middle class and the Catholic bourgeoisie, but the movement also reverberated strongly through Muslim communities and the lower class. The far right has also added its voice to the movement. So campaigns based on an opposition to gender theory have proven to have a very broad base in France. And as Fasson notes, the redefinition of these campaigns is about the theory of gender, made it possible to move between the two battlegrounds, on the one hand marriage and on the other school, because it meant that it was possible to draw lines between the debates about gay marriage. Even once legislation supporting it was passed, so it, they could say, you know, this issue is still alive because it's related to gender. This was a politically astute manoeuvre, he suggests, because schooling, unlike marriage equality, is always a concern for the vast majority. Camille Robtier, a historian of French history, gender and sexuality, also argues French protests against gender ideology in education have been crafted with very particular political agendas in mind. She writes, the theory of gender is a discursive strategy devised by the Vatican and taken up by numerous Catholic activists and intellectuals to counter the rhetoric of equal rights for women and gays and lesbians. In making these connections, Rob C. goes on to argue that these debates about gender are very specific to France. I'm not sure that's the case. And she cites one French politician who, in the context of debates about marriage equality in France in 2013, describes the theory of gender as even more dangerous than same-sex marriage and adoption because it killed nature. In the Australian context, debates about marriage equality have also been continuously conflated with debates about safe schools and questions of gender. As Jill Stark reported in the Sydney Morning Herald last year, David Van Genn, president of the Australian Marriage Forum, makes no secret of the fact that his criticism of safe schools is linked to opposition to marriage reform. Parents need to understand that the genderless agenda is a package deal. If they vote for marriage equality, they are voting for safe schools on steroids. And agreeing to relinquish control of their child's moral education to sexual radicals, he said. So debates about marriage equality are also clearly linked to debates about safe schools by progressive advocates. So Tiernan Brady, a leader of the successful marriage equality movement in Ireland, who's now here in Australia, is quoted by Stark as saying that in a predominantly Catholic country, parents were warned that LGBTI advocates were trying to destroy the family and influence the way children were taught in schools. Explicitly linking debates about gender and sexuality to education and families, Fasson argues, offers opportunities to broaden the base beyond any one specific single issue. This contention is important in understanding the Australian context and speaks to the potency of the campaign against the Safe Schools Coalition. This isn't to say that people weren't genuine in their opposition to the work of the Safe Schools Coalition. It is to argue that the Safe Schools campaign was a useful vector for introducing broader concerns about gender, sexuality, education of children into broader debate. It also suggests that anti-gender mobilisation campaigns will likely have lives beyond debates about marriage equality and following on from the successful attacks against the Safe Schools Coalition. And so with this in mind, something popped up in front of me when I was thinking about these mobilisation campaigns. And so I've been thinking about how the Australian Christian lobby is thinking about gender ideology. And the ACL explicitly connected gender ideology to their campaign against the Safe Schools Coalition in an online blog entitled, "When Will Children Be Safe from Gender Ideology?" And this was posted in November 2016 by Wendy Francis, the ACL's Queensland director. Francis writes that, "Sadly, the Safe Schools Coalition material remains captured by gender ideology. Right now, parents are able to push back against the radical ideology underpinning the Safe Schools program, but everything will change if same-sex marriage is legalised," she warned. "Anyone who thinks the same-sex marriage political movement will stop at the marriage altar is sadly misguided. Promoting cross-dressing, use of genderless toilets, and whole school participation in same-sex marriage rallies is not what parents expect from an anti-bullying program. The possibilities for danger are endless here." What is meant by the term gender ideology is not explicitly outlined in the blog, but it is linked to how schools deal with matters related to gender and sexuality in areas that might be considered to be subject to debate within the broader community. The concerns expressed by the ACL in relation to the Safe Schools Coalition share many of the hallmarks of campaigns against gender being waged internationally in places such as France, Ontario, Canada, and Colombia, as I demonstrated in the slides. But what has surprised me most in reading about the ACL's anti-gender campaigning in Australia is the scope of their campaign and the sorts of concerns they are articulating about the place of studies of gender in the curriculum. In August last year, the ACL made an unsuccessful submission to the Board of Studies of Teaching and Educational Standards in New South Wales. The ACL's submission focused on the draft English curriculum, particularly targeting its focus on gender perspectives. The ACL submission argues for the removal of definitions of gender and critical literacy, which are found in the glossary of the draft syllabus, because they say separating the socio-cultural role of a person's sex, male or female gender, from their biological sex has no basis in genetics or sexual development. The ACL also expressed concern about how the draft curriculum encourages exploration of the ways notions of gender identity are constructed in language and values of the text, because this is an area laden with cultural and political sensitivities. For the ACL, the associated risks in teaching young people about gender are elaborated in their submission to the New South Wales Curriculum Authority. They argue some teachers may not be equipped to cope with all these perspectives and avoid personal bias in their teaching as they start to tackle notions of gender that may be unfamiliar to them, or they may be ill-equipped with students who are yet to form their own sense of self and are trying to relate to a character or perspective. The ACL and Joan Scott both underscore how difficult it is to pin down the idea of gender. Scott, writing in 2013, argues, "Rather than, as I had mistakenly thought, becoming clearer over time, gender has become more elusive, the site of contestation, a disputed concept in the arena of politics. There are, of course, still feminist uses of the word, but it is now a term of reference across the political spectrum, with effects sometimes very different from the ones feminists originally intended. So in seeking to intervene in debates about gender and the uses of gender, different issues are being brought together that are impossible to separate. For example, relations of power between men and women, sexual difference, different beliefs regarding sexual and gender identity and their malleability, ideas about marriage and monogamy, and religious and sexual freedom. These topics all surfaced in the ACL submission, which includes testimonies from students and parents who express concern that their ideas about sex, sexual values and sexuality will be critiqued by peers and teachers in classroom context. And I can tell you that for teacher educators, it's a huge concern for them as well, that whenever they talk about gender or sexuality, that it will be misconstrued and therefore they just don't want to talk about it. The ACL submission also argues for the removal of the cross-curriculum learning area difference and diversity from the syllabus, because words such as diversity and difference are politically laden terms broad enough in the meaning that their placement within the curriculum, particularly with reference to gender, may allow for the politicisation of the curriculum. So the campaign against the Safe Schools Coalition was successful in bringing about the defunding of that program. Though the campaign against the use of the term gender and in opposition to cross-curriculum learning related to diversity and difference was not successful. The new Stage 6 English curriculum has retained the language that the ACL thought problematic in both instances. While the public may be less familiar with the campaign related to the English curriculum, in the eyes of the ACL, these two campaigns, I think, are very much related. Both campaigns seek to shine a light on how gender is understood in schools and in the broader community, and to make an argument for very specific types of understanding, one that's, I think, clearly at odds with many scholars in gender studies. I think, actually, many scholars in gender studies don't even know that this sort of thing is happening around gender ideology. Implicit within this critique is the idea that the curriculum can be a neutral document, guiding teachers in how to teach young people about society in a way that can treat all perspectives without bias, and not have any political influence on the formation of young people's character. But we know that all schooling will have an influence on the formation of young people's character, and issues related to gender, sexuality, sex and religion will always play a part in education, regardless of whether schools are labelled as religious, independent or public, and regardless of whether schools make this explicit in their curriculum. Gender identity, religious and sexual freedom in Australian education. Coming to the end. So, in writing about the field of gender studies in Belgium, Sarah Brack, a sociologist of gender and sexuality at the University of Amsterdam, bemoans what she terms the rise of gender light. She perceives this as the result of the under-theorising of the concept of gender. The notion is all too often collapsed into sex and functions as a binary sociological parameter without any meaningful investigation into cultural construction, she writes. Brack also characterises gender light as discussion of gender without feminism, gender without power, but also gender without sexuality, race or ethnicity, and I would add religion and culture. Drawing on Brack, what might be preferred by the ACL as something akin to gender light, in which gender is easily likened to biological sex, I think this is an idea regularly mobilised in campaigns for gender equality within government and industry. Writing about debates regarding gender in France, Fassin bemoans the ways in which the concept is mobilised in the name of democracy. For Fassin, a democratic approach to gender is one founded in critique, a place where the order of things is presented explicitly as a social, not a natural order, steeped in history and thus subject to change. Fundamentally political and thus an object of critique, liberty and equality become legitimate claims whose very definitions are at stake in these political struggles concerning both gender and sexuality. And to my mind, for many gender studies scholars, this is kind of still the way that critiques of gender, I think, operate within this idea of critique that doesn't really, I think, make much admission for belief. And I think that that's a problem in the way that gender critiques get articulated, and why we also become very adversarial very quickly. Joan Scott is critical of Fassin's vision of sexual democracy. She rejects his thesis that debates about gender are a function of world historic confrontation between the forces of order and the champions of change, the conservative defenders of patriarchy and the progressive proponents of sexual democracy. For Scott, gender as a category in a field of study continues to be important when it is not a guide to static categories of sexed identity, but to the dynamic and contested interplay of imagination, regulation, and transgression in the societies and cultures we study. Gender studies, she writes, should provoke an unending set of questions and open the way to new thinking, Gender is a perpetually open issue, and when we think it has been settled, we know we're on the wrong track. So returning to my point of departure in this lecture and the story about me and my dad, Scott's response to Fasan, I think, is a useful bookend. She is careful to undo the fantasy that questions of gender can be settled. This is something I knew intuitively, if not theoretically, at the time of my conversation with Dad about my thesis. But I suspect that I thought that my shiny new gender expertise meant that my understandings of gender had more value than his perspective. Almost 20 years later, I feel much less settled about questions of gender. This feeling can certainly be troubling when one feels called upon to defend a particular gender perspective and not just ask unending sets of questions. While I may be less sure about how gender might be defined, I am more committed to finding opportunities to do research and to stage public conversations such as this one, related to the intersections between gender, sexuality, religion, and education. There is much public dialogue about religiosity, gender, and sexuality in Australia today, but I think these conversations are too often staged in adversarial tones. Supporters of marriage equality are currently trying to cultivate conversations across Australia about this important topic in ways that resist this approach. Researchers in feminist theory and gender studies, I think, have an important role to play in these debates, trying to expand common sense understandings of gender, sex, and sexuality in Australia. Indeed, for me, one of the lures of coming to ANU was the opportunity to engage better with key politicians, cultural institutions, and policymakers on questions regarding religion, belief, sexuality, gender, and education. This engagement will draw on my own work and others' work in these areas of research. It will also seek to resist the temptation to assume the progressive position on questions of gender, sex, and sexuality. That's it.
Thanks very much, Mary Lou. That was absolutely fantastic, as I expected, and every bit as good. I guess my question here is around the construction of young people. And it's quite a simple question, but it's a question I think is important in the sense that this, to me, seems to be something that is very much imposed upon young people as a category, as a framework, as a, you know, diagram of how one should be in there, you know, and there's all the politics around that. But I'm kind of interested in why young people aren't part of the conversation more and what that says too about that discourse of them being, you know, the objects of this and the subjects of it, but often marginalized and silenced in the process. And so I'm just thinking in a very radical thought and in a different type of alternative society or reality, how this might be worked out by young people themselves without any of the discourse and frameworks that are being posed upon them.
It's a great question. Obviously there's lots of reasons why that's not happening in terms of, like, you know, political structures and sensitivities, but putting those aside, I think that there are, like, amazing things that young people are doing that we don't often hear about. So if you think about the Safe Schools Coalition, for instance, and also Minus 18. Like, Minus 18 is, like, largely run by young people, and the resources that were most controversial were resources produced by young people themselves. And they, like, so, and I think that those resources spoke to a lot of people and a lot of young people about how they're thinking about gender now, and they were very powerful resources. And they were, so the Minus 18 resources are still up and they're still being produced, but it's a matter of getting the word out about them as well. But I think that there are also, like, great parodies of, conservative ways, I think, and progressive ways of thinking about gender online. So there's a whole lot of online cultures happening that are, you know, expanding the way that we understand these things. And if you think about something like Facebook and its 37 gender categories or whatever it is, like, that's speaking to how young people, I think, are imagining, like, what gender is today, which is not within a binary, I don't think.
Look, I just wanted to ask the question, I guess, about the kind of work that the category of gender is being asked to do. And So at the end there, where you sort of said, you know, that you think there's something really important to be done in the area of expanding common sense understandings of gender. I couldn't agree more. I guess it seems to me that there's also that thing where the concept of gender ends up bearing the burden of being the one denaturalizing concept. And, you know, I think a lot of the issues that someone like Moira Gatens raised many years ago about the sex gender distinction, you hear those things play out again and again and again. And I suppose, so I guess my question is, given that it, you know, we're not kind of talking about an innocent process of education here. Like, we're talking about an absolutely agonistic struggle. What sort of a role in bringing about some kind of change is played at the level of attack? You know, at the level of saying, look, actually, what about this category of family, for example? You know, why shouldn't it be us to do the work of denaturalizing itself? This category of marriage or... Because it does seem that one of the issues that people who are trying to think through gender questions get stuck with all the time is they're always being asked to be included in a mainstream that excluded them in the first place. So.
I've been thinking of doing a project called Australian Family Planning for that reason, like that's trying to think about, you know, the idea of the family and really trying to expand that idea of the family, because gender is so loaded. I think it touches on a lot of the, I don't think it gets us out of the problem of gender entirely, but I think that you're right, it can be a powerful maneuver. But whenever I've talked to people about that project, I just end up in conversations about family planning as it was imagined, you know, I think quite a while ago. And I think that anybody who knows anything about family planning now knows it's much more complicated than that. But the resonance of family and trying to play with that and subvert it is much harder to do, I think, as well. So it's a great point, I think. Yeah,
just actually following on from that, I mean, sorry, is this working? Okay. I mean, it's interesting to think about the relationship between teachers and family, because, of course, the teacher acts in loco parentis. That's their legal status in relation to the child. So if they're acting in loco parentis, it raises the question of the parentis bit, because it suggests that the kind of ways in which they're a bit of a pivotal point in these much, as you were saying, these much broader contestations around the family, the heterosexual normativity of the family, and of course this is an absolutely fundamental category in the new right. The rise of the new right that we're seeing particularly in the States, I think, but also in Europe.
I mean, and that's one of the reasons why I'm quite focused on this now in Australia, because I think that actually ideas around gender are going to become hotter. And I think that we really saw with the election of Trump, I think a lot of progressive commentators really missed the importance of ideas about gender and the part they were playing. People, I think, saw Trump talk about women in a particular way, and that meant that women wouldn't support Trump. And they didn't think it, you know, I think as much about, and other people have said this, like the Supreme Court and questions about abortion and family that I think are fundamental to a lot of people. And I think that trying to, for me, what I would like to see is like ways in which young people can be engaged in conversations at school around these issues, but not in ways that foreclose it either way. And I think that there that really both modes of address often really just close down the conversation in advance. And that's like one of the parts of the ACL submission that I think that I kind of agree with, is that it's actually, I think, become harder to say like, well, actually I'm homophobic, and then to have a conversation about that rather than just say, well, you know, you're an ignorant person and like, you know, just get with the program. And so I think that, but for teachers in their loco parentis, they're like, and there's no sexuality education at all given to teachers. So then how does that like compound all these issues as well?
Thanks, Mary Lou. I was really interested you talking about some of the research about how these sort of anti-gender campaigns have been born out of fears of the sort of denaturalization of sex and then in turn and sort of greater fears about the denaturalization of sexuality, which leads to questions about the family and all of that kind of stuff. I'm wondering if you have any thoughts about progressive moves to try and renaturalize sexuality, in particular with the sort of born this way narrative, and to a lesser extent, renaturalize sex with sort of ideas about transgenderism, for example, being a biological trait or something that's genetic, and whether you think, why do you think this is occurring as a narrative, and do you think it's a reaction to that, and do you think it's potentially effective or non-effective reaction to this sort of this denaturalization, the reaction to the denaturalization, if that makes sense?
It does make sense. Like, I think that the answer is that there's lots of different reasons why people go to essential arguments around trans issues, like there are around gay and lesbian issues. And those questions are unsettled, I think, still in both camps. And I think that, and people, like I know people who use the biological arguments in schools to try and get a foot in the door to talk about trans stuff in schools. And it might be that they don't necessarily agree with all of it, but they think this is a way that I can have a conversation about this in the space of schooling, and that's the most important imperative right now. So I think that some of it's strategic, but I think that some of it is quite conservative, and some of it is like a sense that, like, really, sex is completely naturalized. And I was like, that debate that you had with Helen Razor and who was the other person?
Guy Rundle.
Like, that has been like spinning in my mind, that conversation about like their attack on queer theory and like how they're thinking about queer theory and calling it into question. And I think it's a really important sort of conversation to have in light of what you're asking.
I just wanted to jump in there and just point out that the biology is at least as complex and conflicted and as much a field of debate around endocrinology, genetic, the genomics and
Absolutely,
genetics of
yeah.
sex as any social sciences.
And Cordelia Fine's Testosterone Rex that just came out. I think, really speaking to that incredibly powerfully. Yeah. Testosterone Rex, which is Cordelia Fine's latest book, which is really trying to...
It's popular sort of science.
Yeah.
Yeah, terrific.
Thank you. I'm not sure that I have a question. I want to tell you about Poland. I was actually really fascinated. Something came out of the printer the other day, and I think it was one of the papers, and I started reading it. It was about this anti-gender campaign in France, and I was really fascinated by it because it's been happening in Poland in a far more ferocious and vitriolic way for a time now. And I suppose the intersection, and I think Poland would be a really interesting case study for you because, unlike France, and correct me if I'm mistaken, this is the country that has a concordat with Vatican. Mm. So the intersection of education, Catholicism, and enabling spaces to discuss gender, sexuality. Mm-hmm. And I think a lot of people have said fear. And I think, to me, fear is a critical agent in the debate because it is, to my mind, a lot about the fear of the future. And the state and parents want to have some control over what's taught at schools. And it's also a very interesting case study, Poland, because there's absolutely no way that teachers could be openly, rainbow in their workplace. Effectively, this is a country where everybody's undergoing Catholic education, even though schools nominally aren't Catholic, and you can opt out. But if you do, you'll be stigmatized. So there are a lot of very interesting, things to be illustrated there. But just to be very short, because this is your lecture, not mine, I think the problem in Poland in terms of generating any kind of space for the discussions around gender and sexuality is that as soon as these discussions are started, you immediately touch upon a whole broad range of moral values, like family, marriage, but also the notion of nationality. And it is extremely difficult to kind of keep track what is being discussed. At the same time, it becomes very emotional. It's almost like a form of a crusade. So because you've introduced this element of comparison, I would like to hear your reflections on perhaps how kind of good or how positive the debate of gender and sexuality has been in Australia on the against this canvas of, you know, international events, debates, and sort of lack of ability to even you know, offer some very basic legal protection to young people who are in education and they feel they don't fit in with Catholic ideology, mm-hmm. with the division between, you know, sexual male and female and cultural male and female.
I've just written a piece about the Safe Schools controversy, and one of the things I think about it, I'm using the idea of counterpublics, and in order to try and think about the Safe Schools debate and what it might, because I think that people have often focused on the Safe Schools debate and the harm that it's done, and I'm trying to think about what it's enabled, and in that paper, and I think that, like, I found lots of newspaper headlines about penis tucking and chest binding, and I think that maybe for the first time in, like I found one of those headlines in a regional area in Queensland, and I think that it's interesting that that is what people woke up to in the morning, and they, who got to read that headline? Who got to think for the first time, this is a thing? So even though, so I think that there's the sanctioned public conversation that's going on in places like Poland, and there's the fear about what the debates might, you know, unload here because of what happened with the Safe Schools Coalition debate. But I also think that interesting moments are opening up as well because of the proliferation of discourse about gender and sex and gender bathrooms and all these things, like, you know, I think that, I mean, I'm not saying it's all good by any means, but I'm saying it's also people's, I think, common sense understandings are being inevitably expanded by these things.
Thanks, Mary Lou. That was really extremely interesting. And I would like to go back to your original, disclosure about your discussion with your father and this notion that there's a real binary, you know, in the most simple way of seeing gender in society. But going into the field of social psychology, there's been an enormous amount of research into attempts to measure characteristics or traits of individuals according to whether they're masculine or feminine. And you know about the BEM questionnaire and all of that sort of thing. And the empirical results have generally found that there's a mixture. Everyone has a mixture of one or the other. Now, admittedly, the questionnaire itself could reflect stereotypes, you know, rather than other kind of natural tendencies or things of that nature in terms of what we think a masculine person is or a feminine person and things of that nature. I'm interested in knowing whether or not this kind of research and the findings of this research, because social psychologists, I think, have generally argued that no one is purely one or the other. You know, so this binary doesn't exist in the way even people see themselves. So does this have any kind of role to play in the debate that you're talking about?
I think that post-structuralism and social psychology get equally dismissed as being pseudoscientific. Or you know, waffle. So, like, I mean, there's gobs. It's kind of a bit like climate change. There's lots of good work and lots of interesting things to be seen if you read. But I think that it's it doesn't necessarily penetrate, and that's not because it's not there.
Right. What about the notion of stereotypes, though? Because all of this is built on the notion that we have an impression of how people fit somehow in this spectrum.
Yeah.
And there's an enormous amount of research on not only just stereotyping and the consequences of it, and gender is one of the areas that's very much stereotyped. In fact, it seems to me that many of the things that are reflected in this debate are based on stereotypes to some extent. And yet there's a lot of research on counter-stereotyping, how you can combat this. And
I appreciate your attempt, but I think that, again, it's like, I think there's also an issue is like How do we speak back to belief? Because kind of like what you're doing there is saying, well, here's, you know, there's all this research, and like, but like if I want to have a conversation with my dad about gender, like dad just tells me what the Catholic Church says about gender. And that's his heartfelt belief is this is what gender is. There's boys and there's girls and that's all I need to know. And he doesn't want it to get any more complicated than that. And I don't think, and I think that that is like that sort of rhetoric and is really linked to how people are talking. Like one of the things I didn't get to in the paper is how Eric Fasan is linking these debates in France to anti-intellectualism, which I think is really another part of what's going on here and also part of the appeal of talking in common sense ways about gender and not bringing good research into the conversation. So I think that we need to find ways to make the research part of the common sense without, you know, asking people to, you know, go and read the sorts of very useful studies that you're talking about. Like how can we inject those into, I think, public debates?
In terms of the question of how do we speak back to belief, I mean, it seemed to me the really important point you made a little while back was that actually just waking up to a headline that, you know, may not do something progressive. It may not, you know, I guess troubling those kind of categories of what would look like progressive thinking and what wouldn't. I mean, isn't that how you speak back to belief, is just by actually something new coming, like pricking the surface and coming into the consciousness that then enters discourse? And so maybe in a way, you know, I guess that's probably what kind of keeps you going with difficult things, is to actually sort of think, well, I may not be sort of seeing any evolution in sight here, but, you know, could we have had this conversation 20 years ago?
I mean, one of the, like, I've been doing work like related to this for quite a while now, and I had a student who was a very Christian young woman. It's how she described herself in one of my classes at Monash. And she came to me after a class where I talked about sexuality, and she said she wanted to talk to me. And I was kind of like sucking in, thinking, you know, how's this going to go? And she said, I think I'm queer. And I thought she was about to come out to me, which, you know, wouldn't be the first time. And she said, I'm queerly religious. And she wanted to have a conversation about like how her ideas about religion, like, you know, were kind of similar to my ideas about, you know, gender and sexuality. And like, you know, could we talk about that? Which I thought that was a moment when I thought that that sort of opening was happening. And neither of us were trying to convince each other of the rightness of our positions, but we were looking for places where Anne Pellegrini talks about places where religion and sexual feelings touch, which I find a really useful idea for trying to think about this stuff.